Can I ask you one thing, Aaliyah? When it's done, can you just hit end stream? It's really, that's all you gotta do. Hit end stream.
Sure.
And then once it ends, you can just close this and it's fine.
Sure, you got it.
Thank you so much.
So John asked Aaliyah, it's already recording.
Okay.
In other words, all the way to the back, or are we just this nice little circle?
I think it might just be. I'll go and look on the list. I think there was probably at least six or seven.
Yeah, but they said you don't need to sign up.
Yeah.
Oh, that's true. Yeah.
So the list could say.
The list could say 5, 15, or 10.
And it could be a bunch of people signed up, and then like we did, found out afterwards the whole thing is an hour.
Yeah, I'm 15 now.
Right.
Yes.
I'm 15.
But yes, because I know previously mini talks has been like one, and then after half an hour another one, and another.
Yeah,
yeah. Just like,
yes.
Yeah,
that's right.
Oh well.
Yeah, I don't know.
I'm just here waiting.
And you are?
Aaliyah.
Nice to meet you.
Chris? Nice to meet you. Yeah. Originally England, Canada, but mainly working with Bristol Ministries, which is
so you live actually in
Sichuan.
Yes.
And how about you?
I'm from America, Iowa, and then
okay.
Staffing the DTS.
DTS, so I hope
you
deal with them.
Yeah.
Blessing.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
So this is my first conference.
Okay.
Yeah. So this is part of their outreach, and then are you doing other stuff in Hungary or elsewhere?
From here, we'll go to Macedonia.
Okay.
For 3 weeks, and then Albania.
Okay. It's kind of nice that you'll get to meet people that you'll be connecting with probably ahead of time.
We're meeting up tomorrow for lunch. We're meeting with our contact for Albania.
Yeah.
Which is nice.
Nice.
It's like she's here.
Yes. Exactly.
We
otherwise,
just,
it's just yeah.
We can just talk.
Yeah.
Here and
I'll
worry about it.
Yeah. Well, it gives DTS folks a little bit more of a sense of what my mum is, what they're part of.
Yeah,
and
it's
yeah.
Just like, oh, if I joined this region, people are
Who are
just like, playing around with it.
Okay.
Yeah.
Well,
we
were,
so it's just like,
but
it's nice.
This is nice. You can tell them, but it means much more to actually come and be part of it, doesn't it?
But
yeah.
Yeah.
Right now, he's actually asking when they're going to end the talk.
They
might have
they
talk
they
to
yeah.
Whenever
so,
I find out what's going on.
Yeah.
Where are you, by the way?
Yeah.
I was
are you having lunch right now?
Live streaming. That
okay.
Is on.
Oh,
it's already on.
Yeah.
Great.
Okay. And I have a question. Do you know how long these are supposed to be?
That's a question.
Well, I'll
think
yeah, I'll text you.
Oh, okay, so
yeah.
It's actually a full session. Because
yeah.
I thought we were going to have these things where you talk for 10 minutes. And
that's what we,
that's
guess what we, they
that's
did,
what
cause
we
they,
all thought.
Yeah, because they said mini talk, and then someone said, no, it's just one, and it could have been one.
Yeah.
I thought
so
they said 1:45 till 3.
So, do you mind if I take a chair? I don't like to stand up.
No.
I don't have any notes. More kind of an informal.
Do you want to just talk like a big circle? Or
yeah,
think
yeah.
Yeah,
big,
let's just
do
make a circle.
Yeah,
yeah let's make it. I tend to be a lot more.
Yeah.
The start of the
circle,
yeah.
3:30.
It just
kind
yeah.
Okay.
He needs to be.
Are you in the chat?
No.
I'm not, but.
Where do I put
that?
I think that's the
okay.
Camera. All right, so you get lined up for the camera.
Well, there's a camera.
Yeah.
We
want
to record it, you know, so, so maybe to make it cool, kind of,
yeah.
There's not going to be very many people.
Okay.
Get some,
I'd love to join you guys, if at all possible.
Yeah, please do.
Please.
Yeah.
Yes, we just decided to make it self-evolving.
Yeah.
Did you get your swim in, Nikita?
No. No.
You just put on your swimming trunks, yeah?
Yes. It's raining a little.
You're ready to dive, it's right up.
Okay. I guess probably the best way for us to start would be for us to say our names, where we're from, how long, I guess just how long you've been here, the region you're from. But tell me the country of origin. So, the last 4 years we've been working with
in Sigishwara.
Okay. Yeah. But help us to living in Medyash?
Rate, which is near to Medyash, so that's okay. Our kind of team okay. Center is there, but we actually work with the villages around.
Mm-hmm.
So yeah. So we live in Sigishwara.
Being 4 years, so please
don't say you were there last month, because you know more than I did. Back for a few visits. Say who you are and where you're from.
I'm Janine, I'm originally Dutch.
Someone you started saying very
I met you years ago. I came with Reed to do a seminar.
Oh, that's,
yeah.
You have to tell my wife about
that. No, I did. I chatted to Helen last night. I said, I'm being your home. And so a colleague and I, we did a preschool teacher seminar. Probably.
It was right
after
it's
got
right
the early 90s. Yeah.
Well, this
week
was after we'd done the LPS of 96.
Okay. Right. So mid-90s. Yeah.
Wonderful and Hungarian city.
Got a
good university.
Yeah.
Yeah.
My name is Nicole. I'm from the US and I've been
here
since
November.
Ooh, amazing.
Fresh.
You have
anything
other?
Well, I'm Jack. Yeah.
Well, I'm probably heard yesterday. I'm John. I'm from the United States originally. I've been in Europe for about a half of my a very portion of my life, probably about 35 years in Europe. So, yeah, and living in Poland. My wife, Helen. it there.
It is pretty important.
Well, you know, I thought, you know, there'd be room that would have rather not been sort of this
room. Oh, yeah.
You know, the room that I would have really liked to have been is the room that you come into the reception desk and you go to the left,
uh-huh.
and you've got that small seating area, and the picture of the, probably the count that lived here, you know, this tradition that oozes out of it. So, you know, I'm going to, it was an absolute worst title that you could give on subject, was the history of the region, because everybody hates history, you know, because it's tough. Or it's not taught in a way that gives it meaning, you know? I use history to come up with kind of social thought and also dealing with cultural things. And history is the only way you can get it. And you can't research something that hasn't been. So. By the way, I just, about several years ago, I did finish a PhD in philosophy, and it's about it, but it blended together how community, tradition, and authority are needed before you can actually come to the truth. So, and what I'd like to do is kind of talk a little bit about how this part of the world different than part of the world most of you have known. And it kind of explains, you know, we all live in our histories. Whether you like it or not, you live in history, you're not aware of it. The term that you could use for it is it's passive, it's silent, mild knowledge. And you live in it, and you go from there into the world. You reach out into the world from this body of beliefs that you have, and skills, and you reach out into the world from that. And history is part of, you know, your family histories, and our, you know, national histories. We live in it. And that's why it's such a tragedy that history is so poorly. But what makes Central Europe and the countries east of us so much different than, say, the countries in the West? There's several things that I think are at play. And you have to go back really to the feudal times to understand how things were structured. And in the feudal world, you have five classes. You have the nobility, and then you have the peasants, and then you had your burghers, the people who lived in the towns, in the cities, and then you had the Jews and the clergy, and they're all distinctive classes. Now you have, like in the clergy, you have the clergy who the mothers and fathers had put them into the church service, and they were very poor people. But these clergy would never be able to rise up into the hierarchy. Then you have people, you know, every good nobleman wanted to have, or his wife wanted to have one of her kids be the, you know, be in the service of the church and the dedicated. And he could rise up to become a bishop or a cardinal. you know, when the nobility lived here, and this system extended this part of the world up until the end of the Second World War. You know, they said they had abolished it and everything, you know, and the peasants were free, but many of the people were not able to establish themselves on their own, so they basically remained in the hire of the nobility. And okay, so you have the the nobility. I know, like for example, in Poland, and I'm sure it was that way here, because this whole feudal system was very much, you know, it was all across Europe, especially the Western Europe. It was all, the system was, the church supported it and the empire supported it. And it was the way, these levels of the nobility was the way that the kings were kind of put into check. And basically, the feudal system came from the northern the Germanic tribes, which would be the Scandinavians and the northern German peoples. And, you know, they kind of had a major freedom amongst themselves, but they also had a hierarchy. So you have these the noblemen and the peasants. And then you have the clergy, as I mentioned. And the clergy were free of nobility. They were under the church, because Augustine had designed it such that he articulated as there's the prince or the king, and there's the church. So you had a divided power. In the city of God. You had the division of power. Now, that division of power was really crucial. Because anytime you have a division of power, what do you have between them?
Struggle.
Well, you had struggle, exactly. And there was this fight, a tug of war. But between them, there was space. And wherever there's space, there's room for some freedom. Okay, so you had the Catholic Church and the king and then all the nobility under him. But then there was also the small cities. And what was in the small cities? You should know this very good, because Switzerland was able to bypass having kings and this and that, you know, but you're the fiercely independent Swiss, you know, from the inner Schweiz, you know.
Like I said, in the cities you would have had the workmen, the different trades.
The various trades, and how were they governed?
They had trade
the guilds.
Okay.
And they were regulated, and they had rules and things, but you had all these different trades. And they cooperated with each other, because it was only through their cooperation that they would be able to govern the city. You know, the city didn't have a king. It didn't have, you know, a lot of the cities, they didn't have a king. They were free cities. And so they had a kind of a council that was formed out of the leaders of these guilds. Now, there was a saying in the Middle Ages, and it was, Elizabeth and old German, Stadtluft macht frei. City air makes free. So if you could get away and into the city and become incorporated into the city life, you would have much more freedom than the person who lived as a peasant on the countryside. Mm-hmm. Now, you could not move from one landlord to another. You were indentured. You're basically an indentured slave. You know, sometimes when you get a chance to, I'll find we as Wyoming look at a bunch of the museum, but go look at how people used to live in this part of the world. You know? And, just a bit of a twist on that. You know, Stadler 5, the Nazis took that and said, Arbeit macht frei. Yeah, that was over Auschwitz, Arbeit macht frei.
They were changing the same.
They were the same. They just changed the
same.
Yes. So this is the kind of situation that's developing in the Middle Ages. You know, you're starting to get more trade. It developed between, first of all, in the Italian Republic cities. A lot of that was bringing spices over from India and the whole Silk Road and that. But at that time, there was a lot of trade also going on with the Ukraine. You know, so they were bringing grain over from the Ukraine. Now into Black Sea and into the Mediterranean. So you're starting to get this kind of ferment going on. I mean, there was a ferment that was going on that was happening in the area of thought where people realized it was a fascinating story, and it started in the monastery. People thought, we're not able to measure time, and we don't know when to put the seed in the ground and this and that. And we had calendars, but time was not measured very well. And then it started, how could you best measure time? Look at the stars. Because they're different, through the course of the year, different positions, different constellations. And so the monks, actually, as early as the 12th century, began to kind of investigate this. And they did it on the basis that God had made this world. And this was the starting point that they departed from. And it's they laid the foundations for what later would become modern science. And then an important part of this was The Protestant Reformation basically kind of got started in places that were most weakly associated or connected to Rome, or else already had something of your own tradition. Like in England, you have the Celtic traditions. And so, they kind of kept fermenting in the system. But then the Germanic peoples, they didn't like the fact that they were having to pay all this money, and then bought it with the Pope. All this money was going over to Rome and stuff. And you have John Hus there in Prague. And how many of them did Prague? But how many went to see if Bethlehem, where the Bethlehem Chapel was? Yeah, it's fascinating. It's about 100 meters square on each side, and every service there would be 2,000 people in there, packed in there, listening. But where did the Reformation take place? See, we always think it was the Bible was a central point, and that's why it happened. The Reformation didn't happen in Spain. It didn't happen in Poland. They're Catholic countries, but why? Was it just theological? Your name is?
I'm Angela.
Angela.
Thanks.
Where did the Reformation take place?
Germany.
In Germany, but Switzerland? Where did it really grab hold? Holland?
Also Hungary.
But it...
That was actually...
And what did they have socially? They had small cities. The Reformation happened in small cities. It was in the there was a social context in which the Reformation happened. In the places where you didn't have this social context, the Reformation did not really take hold. I'm talking very black and white terms, okay? So it can't be absolute, you can't make it so absolute, but Poland, there was quite a successful Reformation in Poland. And, but you know who became Protestants? They didn't have a city. Oh, I forgot. Did I mention the Jews when I mentioned five?
Yeah.
Okay, yeah. So the Jews were part of it. Okay. They didn't have a small city culture development. The ones who were serving by providing the goods to the nobility, you know, the luxury goods and nice tables and furniture and this and that, who was providing that to them? No, because they didn't work in the city.
Yeah, I think you're saying about the Jews.
The Jews,
they were able to trade from one country to the other.
Yeah, it was the
had
Jews.
All the contacts.
Yeah,
right?
And the Jews became, they had their own little settlements. They were not allowed to mix with the other people. And so they learned to deal with money very well. And, they became, and if you were a Jew in one part of Europe, you could connect with Jews in any other part of Europe. And that's where they got to be kind of dominant in the banking trade. And, you know, you could not bank, you could not have banks in Europe up until the Protestant Reformation in Switzerland. You know, if you were dealing in banking, which is basically loaning money and interest, it was forbidden by the Catholic Church. Usury was forbidden. And so the Jews took it. You know, they became the place where you would go to for money. And it was only with the Reformation in Holland that you had the Calvin sat down and says, you know, if you have money, it's like seeds. And, hi Laura.
Sorry,
you honor us with your presence. So anyway, I'm going to be going all over the place today. I don't have a straight line in my thought here, you know, but I'm hoping you kind of get a picture of what I'm talking here. So, but Calvin said, look, you've got money and you could put it, you can invest it in your own business and expand it, or you can make it available to other people. And he thought about it, what is the percentage rate that you're allowed to ask for interest? And it was 3%. You just figure that, you know, you're risking losing it. There's several other factors, but it should grow by at least 3%. So you can loan at 3% interest rate. And for a long time, this was the standard that was held in Switzerland. And I think they only broke away from this in the 1970s or something. going back to places like Poland, Spain, Hungary, who became Protestants? So who became? It was the nobility. The nobility became in Poland, in Hungary, and in Spain. They became the primary carriers of the Protestant religion. And it failed. Because this was a time when they were going through a major change. We're going from the Middle Ages and moving into the modern era. And everything is under change. And when there's a lot of change like this, it's oftentimes where God works. You know, but he works seemingly in natural mechanisms, if I can say that. You know? I mean, the social system also was very important. You had to have some capital in order to do evangelism and develop new churches and things. And so the capitalist class, the small merchants, they became the ones that embraced the Protestant religion, and it also fit their mentality, you know, that we'll have a church government with elders. And so it was, you start having a leveling down of the hierarchy. But in Poland, Hungary, the really Catholic regions that were not penetrated by the Reformation, the nobility was great. They became Protestants, but they were still in the old structure, and the world was changing. The old order was passing, and I suspect if you go down there, downstairs, look at that picture of that nobleman, I suspect he was a Protestant Calvinist. Because most of the nobility in Hungary were Calvinists. But the peasants stayed Catholic. And those of us that are from the States, or from Western Europe, Holland, Switzerland, nations that were really affected by the Reformation, were used to a totally different kind of a culture. It took hundreds of years for this to kind of evolve. But Central Europe wasn't that way. Well, let me tell you a little story. The story of a Hungarian woman who was born near Bratislava. See, the Hungarians used to own most of Slovakia. They owned large parts of Romania, and they also was under their rule, and also Croatia. And they were the kind of dominant power. And anyway, this young lady was raised born about 1920. And she was born in a very poor family, peasant family. And her mom and dad could hardly provide food for her, for the family. They had 9 children. Very small holding. They had 9 children, and there was a nobleman and his wife in the nearby area, and they didn't have any children. So they came to this family and they said, "We'd like to adopt one of your daughters, and we'll pay you for it." And so parents have other children will have plenty to eat, more to eat. And she's going to have a good life. She can get educated. being the nobleman came to pick her up, and she squalled like crazy because she did not meet her parents. And her mom's heart broke. And she said, oh, we might not have enough food, but we're going to be together. So this young woman grew up. Well, she went through life. At that point in time, there had been a real reform movement, and children would get at least an eighth grade education. So she got up to eighth grade education. Although she was pretty bright, and she learned. She loved reading. She loved math and all that stuff. But that's all the food that she could go. So she hired herself out to a local orphanage to do baking and cooking. And this is 1920s. Now, I realize I'm jumping all over the place and telling the stories to kind of get an idea. These orphans were, you know, there were shifting borders between Czechoslovakia and Hungary. And the Hungarian orphans all had to go down to Budapest. So this young woman is, you know, a teenager, she decided to join the orphans because she got to be friends with them, join them in going down to the border and just get off the train and go back to her parents, which is not a very long trip. But she woke up and she was in a big city. Never been in a big city. It was night. So she decided, okay, I'm gonna work here. I'll be the baker here. And she's horribly lonely. Her parents are living with her parents and all this stuff. It was a really tough time. One day she was walking through the city. Nice city, but you know, it was a lonely place. She was completely single. And so she went into this building. It turned out to be a Protestant church. She didn't know it was a Protestant church. So she went into it, and these women in the church just loved her. She just kept going back, and she eventually converted. And she went to the pastor, and she says, what do I do? My father's written me a letter, and says, please come home. And that means we're going to have to go back into the Catholic discipline. Home and see if they're home. What's that? Incredibly fast. So she did that. Lived through the Second World War. Germans came in, took over their house. And the Russians came in, they just had to hide. I hid under the house. Somebody squealed on him and hit him these guys because if you're a woman or a girl and the Russians come, you're going to get raped. You need to find it. So they just hit him. That was my mom. So I kind of have a sense, a little bit of a sense of what this part of the world is. More existential up here. But it was not nice being in heaven. But why weren't there changes? Why couldn't there be changes in the strict feudal system? Well, right around the time that the Protestant Reformation happened, we had something else happen. It was called the Second Feudalization. And there had been the feudal system before that, but when the Second Feudalization happened, that meant that you could not leave the land. Before that, you could leave the land, you could maybe move to another landlord or something like that, but you couldn't leave the landlord. You were basically enslaved. And, you know, the one place of comfort that people found was in the church. Go to church, confess your sins, or the feasts, and all the things that went along with that. And by the way, the Catholic calendar was so full of feasts that, and the landlord had to provide the food, the feasts. And probably half the year was feast day. And so basically you lived off of your landlord and the landlord lived off of you. And it was not a very good system. It basically, what I think happens when you get one group of people above another group of people, lording it over them, what happens is both sides lose creativity. Those that are above and those that are below lose creativity. And, you know, a good businessman, why is he good? He's creative. He sees opportunities that nobody else sees. And I think one of the most wonderful gifts of our goodness is creativity. And the system was bound to squash it. And that's why it didn't grow. It became very stagnant. I just recently read a book by a man that was very involved in the Hungarian Revolution. He was born in a nobility family. He describes how it was on these, when they would get together in the family, you know, bigger extended family, they'd all go to uncle's palace. It was normal. It was dead. There was just no life there. But the relations between the nobility and the peasants, I mean, the sons of the nobility, and this wasn't all of them, it was, I'm sure, very godly, but there was power, and power tells them to mess us up. And, you know, the sons of the noblemen regularly preyed on the peasants' girls. It was not a good system. And like Hungary, we had a few cities, but most of it was these large estates. I don't know what the size of this estate was, but it was probably, you know, a few thousand hectares of land that were here. And it was all farmed by hand labor, no tractors, it was done by hand labor. I remember there was they had this meeting in the early days of Wyman, and there was a young man from Holland who had been raised. His father worked on the estate of a Dutch nobleman. And it was one of those times when they're ministering to people. Don Stevens that was praying for this guy, this Dutch guy, and he said, "I see you, and there's a big, beautiful house. And I see another house. It's really small, and it's kind of squalor. It's not a nice house." And he began to talk about it, and this guy just broke down, and he wept and wept and wept. He'd been raised second-class citizen. And those of us that are from the Western world don't realize what it meant. You know, the change that we went through when the concept of the individual having rights, having freedom, we grew up with them. But that wasn't everything. And really, all that happened when communism came into this part of the world, it was still it was not very well developed. The places where it had been developed, where the Industrial Revolution finally began to come in, there was just really the peasants that moved in from the city to the, or from the countryside to the city, were really taking advantage. They made their life a little bit better, but not that much better. They kind of was like jumping from the frying pan into the fire. They maybe had more opportunities if they could save money, but a lot of times they have horrible problems with drink, and you know the social conditions were really bad in those places. And so for most people, they didn't, it was moving from the countryside into the city, it was not a good move. Now, one of the things that did happen, I was talking to a friend of mine, he said, it was very interesting because the Baptist movement, when they started in Eastern Poland, one of the first things they did was taught people how to read the Bible. And when they this was the beginning of the 20th century. So you got, you know, people converting to becoming Baptists, and they go, well, I need to be reading my Bible. So they taught people how to read and write. Those people became prized people by the small merchants because they were honest and they could actually do math and read and write. And this is how the Baptists began to rise in the society. In the Bible, you know, Laura always talks about the Bible and the influence of the Bible, but this was another one of those demonstrations that when the Bible came in, suddenly you have this upswing and people's lives are able to get disciplined, more disciplined, and the drink doesn't become such a big issue with them, and their lives improve. So, yeah. But what was happening in this part of the world now, we're moving to the 19th century, the beginning of the 19th century. What happens in Western Europe? What's the big thing that happens at the beginning of the 19th century? End of the 18th century. Okay, Industrial Revolution. Okay, well, that's one thing, yeah. Your second word's right. The French Revolution. French Revolution. And there was the in the Protestant world, the concept was the Reformation was not about religion only, it was about bringing small changes implemented. With the French Revolution was, we're going to change everything right now. And the ideas of the French Revolution made their way eastward. And in this part of the world, what was really strong was you had all these different languages and nations, but they weren't nations. They were parts of empires. But these people spoke their own language. And when it mixed with the French Revolution's ideas and some of the philosophers like myself, kind of we're a nation, we're special. Yes, every nation's special, but they began to think, we're really special. So you have this movement towards nationalism. And it was very strong in this part of the world. And so it was like every 20 years in Poland, we have a major revolution during the 19th century. It's like clockwork. And there was a really big revolution, I think, 1849, was it? Laura, here? 1821. In 1821, there was another one in 1849, wasn't there? Wasn't Kosuth in 1849? Yeah. And so there's this drive to become a sovereign nation. These are the people I can associate with. You can't have freedom without people you're associated with. The freedom comes from associating with one another. You can't have freedom just as an individual. And so they thought they would form a free nation, free individuals around the national idea. And so the 19th century was really, first half was really dominated very strongly by the nationalist idea. But then 1849 had this revolution all over this part of the world, and it was all crushed. You know, them big empires put it down. What else happened in 1849? Know your history at all. Somebody wrote a book. He used to hang out in the British Library. Marx. Marx wrote, I think it was his Gossamer book. He wrote that. And it appealed to a whole different group of people. It appealed to the proletariat, the factory workers. And so that's where the communists began to agitate amongst the factory workers. There was this mass movement of people into the state. So they were appealing to the factory workers, but they were also doing it some amongst the peasants. But the peasants were basically so trapped in their situation that they really did not want to change. But they were able to persuade the factory workers, yes, let's strike, let's do all these things, let's get rid of the capitalists. And so you come to the end of the 19th century, and I'll just kind of mention this a little bit too, because it's very important to understand what happened in Europe, for those of us that are not from Europe. At the end of the 19th century, it looked like the great liberal dream of freedom, progress, of reform, all of these things seem to be coming true. On the surface of this, you could travel anywhere in Europe without a passport. You could, there was incredible scientific, this is the second scientific revolution. It was largely centered in Germany. But there's a lot of good things happening, like even in Hungary and Vienna and any major university cities. There's tremendous reform that was going on. Peasants were starting to be educated. This is a flourishing of art. If somebody's signaling that I need to stop. There's tremendous flourishing of arts here. We think about this is a period when the Dutch artist, the Impressionists. Van Gogh, but there's a whole movement in of art experimentation going on, Cubism and all these other things that are happening. But people, it was like we're breaking every frontier, and then boom, 1914. Mm-hmm. Europe was all tied up in just a knot of treaties, and Austria was kind of a big player in this part of the world, and the Turks were moving out. They were becoming the vacuum. So Austria was moving into the vacuum. They came down into what's now Bosnia and Herzegovina. They took military control of that. But Austria-Hungary was a rock from the inside empire. And then the Russians, Russia had a chance at the end of the 19th century and the beginning of the 20th century, they had a chance because they had a very wise agricultural minister. And what he said was, we've got to get people to take responsibility. And the way we'll do that is we'll give people land. We'll go settle land. We'll give them land. They'll have to farm themselves and be responsible. His name is Stolypin. And so Russia was creating a whole group of free farmers. And you know who the first people that the Soviets went after, that the communists went after, was the free farmers. In 1919, about a year after the revolution, they wouldn't sell grain. Farmers, unless they moved to the collective farmers. Now, going to collective farmers, like going back to the big landlords, only now that Komissar is in charge of it. So, that within 2 years of the Russian Revolution, 2 million people, a large part of it was farmers, were starving. And then all of you have probably, I hope you've heard a little bit about the, what's it called, Volodom? The force, you know, they tried to force the farmers to go onto the collective farms. And throughout the Soviet Union, it wasn't just the Ukraine, there was 15 million farmers and their families. They especially hit Ukraine really hard. But I read a book about it, and they said, you know, these boys would look out their windows, and just a man that lived in them said he was a boy when this happened. He said they'd look out their window every morning and they'd go, the smoke's coming out of this house. So they survived over there. There's no smoke coming here. They died. You want to watch a movie that's really worth your time, watch Mr. Jones. I don't know if it's going to be, you're going to be able to catch it. We caught it on Netflix when it came out, one of those channels. But it's a story, it's a true story, actually. It's about a young man in Britain who's working as an assistant for one of the high-ups in the British cabinet. And the depression is starting to come on. And he's told one night, he says, yeah, after the people, I can't pay for your wages anymore. And this guy was a journalist, so he said, well, I'm going to go interview him. So he goes and has an interview with Hitler and published in the newspaper, British newspaper. And he says, yeah. Let's see if I can get an interview with Stalin. And so he flies to the Soviet Union, and he's there in, I guess it's Moscow at the time, and he's trying to set up this appointment with Stalin to have an interview. And he starts hearing about something strange going on in the Ukraine. And you don't have a linear thinker in you, so I'm all over the place. But I'm trying to paint a picture and give you a story, okay? So what he does is, I think his mother had been a Ukrainian. And so he decides, one of the things he wants to do on this trip is he wants to go see where she was raised. So he gets on the train, totally illegal, and he heads down to where his mother had been born and raised. And he's going along, and he realizes they're trying to keep him from going out there. They're really, you know, secret police, and there's all these people involved in trying to keep him from going out there. But he goes there, and Now, back in Britain, they're talking about how wonderful the Soviet experiment was, how glorious things are there. And he realized something's fishy there. He begins to walk and travel through the Russian community. He comes across, or to the Ukraine, he comes across these villages. He meets some children that are just barely surviving. They give him some meat. Cook some meat for him. Taste it. They finally catch him, and they throw him in prison, and then the British extract him out. And he's seen all the stuff. And he comes back and he tries to tell the British public what's going on. And first of all, he has to go through the journalist guild to get the story. They won't believe him. They won't believe him. And so he ends up going back and working as a school teacher in a little remote place in Wales. And one day he hears that this very famous American journalist, he owned a lot of newspapers in the United States, William Randolph Hearst, was coming back to his home area. He owned it, he was mobility, and he had a castle, and he was going to be there. And he said, got to talk to Hearst, because nobody else will listen to me. So he goes to Hearst's castle, and the security says, "What are you doing here?" He says, "I need to talk to Mr. Hearst." Push him away, and he's in desperation, and he had the truth. He knew the truth. He was desperate to get it out. So he just decides to crawl through a window, and he bursts into this living room, or the dining room, where the British and all the Civil War era, and everybody's got all the fancy things, and he says, "I want to talk to Mr. Hearst." And the security come and take him away, and they're dragging him out of the dining room. And Mr. Hearst comes in and says, "What do you want to tell me?" He said, "I want to tell you what I've seen in the Ukraine." And his newspapers presented the story all over the United States. He had newspapers all over the United States. The United States was the only place that was any significant anti-communist movement in the 1930s. And it was because this story came out, people started becoming aware that this kind of thing was going on. So these are just fascinating little things that go on in history. Yeah, it's pretty brutal. The communists came into power in what became the Soviet Union. They were not gentlemen. They're basically out to create, it was a social engineering experiment. We're going to re-engineer a whole society. And we had a president, and he got to do it. Yeah. I mean, he's in many people's eyes in the United States. He looked at him and he looked at him. But he believed that by using democracy, we could re-engineer society. So that's what he was trying to do. But he was sympathetic with the Soviets. So we gave the United States, because the British weren't in the equation, the United States basically made agreement with the Soviet Union that Eastern Europe would become under the Soviet sphere. The people of Eastern Europe, they had a voice in one sense, because there was a 5-year period of time. It wasn't like the communists came in here with their tanks and said, okay, we're in charge here. But they had come through here, so their military was present here. But they went through the machinery of democracy. And what they did was they allowed elections to take place, but they twisted the elections and they messed around with the elections so much that basically they won every election. So you can't say that they militarily took over. They were able to manipulate the democratic process so that they elected communists or socialist governments. And for a couple of years, things were kind of touch and go. But then about 1950, Stalin decided, I'm going to smash the opposition. And this part of the world was basically a prison. Laura, have you ever read about how Hungary was in the 1950s? How was it Hungary in the early 1950s? I mean, it was one of the worst countries. It was really bad.
They had the revolution. I mean, they were attempted to.
Yeah, that was 1956.
Yeah.
But before that, it had been really bad, and they turned on their own. I mean, if you were a communist, you were also very different. The conditions that those people were, put in prisons, the conditions were terrible. I mean, this book that I mentioned at the beginning that I read was by this guy that he was mobility and then he joined the liberals and then became a communist. But he went from 90 kilos down to 45 or 40 kilos. And the brutality, they couldn't let me read what they put in there. It was just, lights on all the time. They'd knock at the door all the time. They couldn't sleep. But what the communists basically tried to do was re-engineer the society. They moved huge masses of peasant young people into the cities. And then what do you do when you get people uprooted from their backgrounds and thrown into barracks and this and that? I mean, the immorality in those places was just horrible. But they kept saying, we're going to create the new society. We're going to create the really just society. People caught on what was going on. Here they had the revolution. It's worth reading about the revolution. If you're here in Hungary, you should take the time to read it. Then there was countries like Poland where they do it. 10 years, it's time to do another revolution. There was an intellectual class here. There was the clergy who was still part of the church, and they still wanted to retain kind of the influence that they had. And then there was the intellectuals. There was workers, intellectuals, and the clergy, and they couldn't get along with each other. The intellectuals looked down at the people that worked. And the Catholic Church looked down at the intellectuals, vice versa. So this is the dominant people. In one country, they were able to finally get them to all come together. The Catholic or the clergy, the workers, And when those three came together, it was meant that the society as a whole was united against them. And interestingly enough, I'm going to jump back to 1962, Jolly Italian, but he's actually very, very astute. And John realized the Catholic Church was really losing. They were in a fortress mentality, and they were losing the fight against secularism. The liberals had won. So he said, "We've got to change. We're not influencing people." So he called what was called the Second Vatican Council. And they had all these bishops and theologians and cardinals meeting together for several years to 1966. Anybody raised Catholic then? Okay. 1966 or 67. But they really sat down, and most of their theology was really biblical. We've got to wake up in this part of the world, because the Catholic Church is an ally. There's things we might not like, but generally their theology is well thought through, and they have some of the best theologians working with us. And so they worked out this whole change, and in 1967 or 66, you've been raised a good Catholic boy or girl. You were going to a good Catholic school, and every day you'd have a mass, and you were learning Latin and everything. You went to church on Sunday to attend the mass, and up to this point in time, the priest stood behind an iron grating. And his back was to the congregation, the whole service, and he performed the Eucharist. And it was all in Latin. And one Sunday you come to church, and the priest was standing there looking at you. And there's no more iron grate. He speaks your language. And it was only about 2 years after that in the United States, a group of Catholic university students were meeting for a retreat. And they felt like they should all go to their own rooms and seek God. And they experienced the Pentecost. They had an outpouring of the Holy Spirit, everyone in their own different rooms. And this is the beginning of the Catholic Church. And in Poland, the Catholic Church had not got under the thumb of the communist government. They kept their ties to the Catholic, to the Vatican. They had diplomatic relations with the Vatican. Now, why did that happen? Because the people were fiercely Catholic. And when they started to do their anti-religion program, they would go out to the villages and small towns and try to remove the crosses and things. And they had workers who weren't necessarily really coordinated or very adept. And they would be taking down a cross from this village square or something. Inevitably, they'd drop it, boom, at 3 o'clock in the morning. And the village would wake up, and the old ladies would come. Lay down in front of the truck and said, "Over our dead bodies." And so they knew they could not come to the church. So they had to let the Catholic Church stay. And the Catholic Church kind of kept the identity of the all these other things that are going on. This is a famous story. 1965, they were meeting at the Vatican Council, and the Polish bishops got together, the cardinals got together, and they said, well, next year is our millennium, 1,000 years of Poland. And they wrote a letter to the German bishops, and they said, we want you to come and celebrate our 1,000 years of Poland. And we want to, first of all, extend to you forgiveness for all the things that happened in Poland because of World War II. Poland, half the Jews that were killed were Polish Jews. And there's a lot of Poles that also died in the German war. And they said, we want to forgive you. But we also want to say to you, as a German nation, we need to ask for your forgiveness, because at the end of the Second World War, we threw out millions of Germans who had lived in Poland for generations. We need to ask you for forgiveness. And I don't know if you kind of get the sense of what's going on. Really spiritual importance going on by these people doing this. And what I believe happened when they took that step was God said, okay, you have spiritual authority over my people in the nation of Poland. Over the nation of Poland. You could not go to a Catholic church during the 1970s and early 80s and walk into the church because there were so many people in the church. They always had loudspeakers outside. 95% of the people were going to church. A lot of it was a protest. But they were still going to church. But it meant that they were looking to the church for authority, not to the state. And then in 1978, the economy is just crumbling. It really was bad. And John Paul had died, and Pope Paul had died, and then Pope John Paul I died after 5 months. And then next thing you knew was you had Pope John Paul II. Was from Poland, and he was the first non-Italian pope in I don't know how many hundreds of years. And he died as a God's man of the hour. He had been a major contributor in the Vatican, writing the Vatican II. And I was reading the story, I was doing quite a bit of my research when I started my dissertation. And there's two British journalists riding in a taxi. And they have those guys look pretty simple. Hopefully I'm not boring you. There are these two British journalists riding in this taxi car. And there's the Polish taxi driver's got his radio on, listening to the news. And something comes over there. And the guy suddenly pulls over to the side of the road and stops. And he just breaks down and weeps. And they say, what happened? He says, we have a Polish pope. And in 1980, he came back for the first time in Poland. And he went, I don't know how many cities, and he held masses in what biggest square areas that they could find space. And studied the kind of he's a bit like Zelensky. He knew how to move the masses. So he knew how to make messages that were more than his words. So he's coming down the ramp in the airplane, and the president of all these communist delegations there, we're going to meet our favorite son, we're going to welcome him back home. So the president reaches forward to shake his hand. Kisses the ground. And what a powerful gesture. He commanded me from that point. And he went all around the country, and he had this huge masses. And like the Krakow, those of you that have been to Krakow, we have the largest green in Europe, the full green in airports. And they had 2 million people short of on the street, or on that green, for the masses. And he just said, well, one of his prayers was, come Holy Spirit, do this. And the other, his message was, be not afraid. And it was no coincidence that 1 year later, almost to the date, solidarity with God. And here you have this movement of workers. They started up in Gdansk, and they struck. And every 10 years, like I said, they'd strike, and they'd go out in the streets, demonstrate. This time, they learned their lesson. They barred themselves into the shipyards and locked themselves in the middle. And knew the communists would not destroy the shipyards to get them out. But somehow, the news got out. I don't know how this happened, but the state media was not broadcasting some of the news. But the word got out that there's a strike going on in the shipyards, and the whole country struck. And I was 1981, I was in Poland when there was a strike that happened. It was a nationwide strike, it was being called. And I remember we were on this bus, and the rules were that if the bus was scheduled to leave the city before a certain hour, it was before a certain hour, if it was already on the move going out of the city, then it was allowed to go. And if it wasn't, if it was still waiting at the bus station, they had to stay there. And so this bus driver was getting ready to drive away, and this guy came on, and he started having a fight with the bus driver. He said, you can't be driving away. And this man came up, and he had a white band around his arm, and had the solidarity symbol on. No gun, nothing. He came in, and that separates him, and he says, what's going on? He listens to this guy, and this guy who is speaking against the bus driver, he says, get out. And the guy went away like a good dog. And I sat there and I said, that is authority. Power, that's authority. So anyway, then, Poland went through about 10 years' time. In 1989, we had the first elections made. The communists wanted to hold on to power, of course. They said, well, we'll keep the upper house. It has to be one party. But we'll let you in the lower house, we'll let it be a free election. We can put up candidates for the lower house. We'll opposition candidates. Not a single that when legitimacy, when it's a question of legitimacy, there was no longer legitimacy. And that's when they to give up. You know, and that's when the move started. And then, of course, a few months later, you have prayer meetings going on in Leipzig and Dresden, where the students and people gathered together and praying. And the tourists that were going to Hungary from East Germany started going out through Austria, and the Hungarian police said, "We're not going to stop them. They can leave." Sure enough, you know, everything came down to Czechoslovakia. The world and home of major dissident leaders, lots of power, and get to become president. We were watching Romania, you know, what happened to Romania right around Christmas time. You know, Romania was a really tough place, and Ceausescu was really brutal. I still remember watching TV. I don't know how many of you were alive when you watched that thing, but and he goes out there and he thinks they're going to cheer him and adore him and everything. You know, he lived in this world of delusion. Start listening, doing. You could just see a moment. You could see, you just realize I've lost it. And that was what we're interested in. But for us, now that's 30 years ago. You know, for us, we're still dealing with hangover. You see the endemic corruption. You know, it's gotten a lot better since we've gotten into the European Union. A lot of people still have a hard time taking the initiative. Places like Romania, the basic Ceausescu basically decided he was going to destroy the family, and you had a whole generation that was being almost raised by the state. And now in Romania, I don't know if it's still happening that way, but so many parents were leaving to go to Italy, Spain, and these other countries to work that children were not being raised by their parents anymore either. So we're still dealing with hangover effect, but some of the things that we're dealing with in this part of the world is still long, long centuries of habits and traditions and structures of authority and community that didn't allow people to really develop their full selves. And I guess it's why we run BTSs. And that's why we do our other schooling, is it's just to help people really find out who they are, find their gifts, and get out and do it. And whatever country you're from, there are people that are really gifted. And if they get free of the things that hang over them, They're going to make a difference. They're going to really make a difference. And I'll just close with this thought. There's a shift in Europe. Mm-hmm. And it's going from west to east. And I mentioned a little bit earlier, you get all of these things kind of coming together, and it marks a change that's happening. We're seeing that happening right now. The city that I live in, Krakow, when we moved there, if you didn't speak Polish, you weren't going to make it. Now, you can pretty much get by in Krakow speaking English. Why? Because it's become an IT hub. We have people from Africa, from Asia, from Latin America, many of us go to a church. We go to a church, and 30 people are Polish, probably 40% are IT workers from the developing world. And Poland shut down its big industries. They just said, if you can't make a profit, we're shutting it down. But there was enough entrepreneurs who could sees the opportunities that the computer is affording, and we developed a real entrepreneurial culture. I was reading not that long ago that the Polish economy is expected to overtake the British economy in about 5 years. Wow. Look at the countries who have been waffling on Ukraine. Germany, at the beginning of the war, Germany, France, to their credit, the British were strong. But Germany and France, they waffled. What are the strong ones? Poland? You know, Poland, the first couple of weeks, the president of Poland, Czech, and Slovenia. All flew or took a train to Kiev in an incredible gesture of solidarity. And how much defense spending is Germany giving right now? Well, it was 0.5% before the war. It's now up to 1.5%. They made an obligation in NATO that they would spend at least 2% of their national budget on national defense. They've never met it. And hardly any of the Western European countries are meeting their obligation. Poland is spending 5%. Latvia, Lithuania, Estonia are spending 5%. They're really keeping the community. I'm sure that's happening in Romania. And this is, you're getting a shift in political configurations, economic configurations, and, you know, we like to quote that verse out of Esther, but for such a time as this, you know, and this is where we need to kind of see ourselves in the scheme of things, you know, and now, I know, like in Poland right now, you know, you've got these middle-class businessmen, entrepreneurs, they're doing very well, and they look at their children and they say, I don't want to send my kids to the government schools. We have Christian schools in Poland that number over 500 students. It's probably 4 or 5 cities. It's a place where we're not ready to take it on in terms of not in terms of establishment, but even trying to influence. And I think we should be influencing because they separate school from religion. You know? But that's going to be happening in some of your countries too. There's going to be a whole demand for better schools for our kids. And this whole thing of the spheres that Wyman talks about, is there a place to be influencing some of this entrepreneurial class that's rising up? And we're not going to be able to do business with them, but can we lay the foundations of why they're doing it? That they see that, I'm called to this. I'm doing what I should be doing. I don't need to be a common missionary overseas. I'm doing what God's made me. With that, I'll close again. I've gone 2 minutes on one time. Okay. But thanks for listening. And I know I took all over the first time.
Thank you very much.
I hope you got a bit of a picture, with all the different strands and things. Thanks for your attention. It's been fun engaging with you. I tell you you're engaged. We moved there in 1989. Every morning we'd get up and say this to him. And we'd be seeing what comes next. I've been involved. I mean, I was in Poland in the early 80s, and I remember if you didn't get somebody into the bread line, if you have grandparents, that was to your advantage because you could stand in the bread line and then your grandparents would come and stand in the bread line while you went to work. So that it was, and the bread line became a place where that became a social network. People sat there in line. Many people complained. They sit there and talk and share the news and things like that. You know. But 1980 was pretty rough. You could hardly gain a boot. It was really. Okay, thank you again.
Oh, you don't have to stop yet.
Well, it's the end.
Because I didn't have a key, so I came.